Miracles chapter 8, or part 8. We've been discussing the book Miracles, what they are, why they happen, and how they can change your life by Eric Metaxas, published last year. And this week we're going to be talking about a lot of what most people mean when they say miracles, which is miracles of healing, or miracles of, if you prefer, they go against what we usually think of as science. The first one I'm going to talk about is a simple healing prayer. Again, we're not going to read them straight through. We're going to be omitting a lot of material, but trying to keep the core of the story together. John Allen Turner from Pepperdine University, Pacific Christian College, and the London School of Theology, and then went into the pastorate. One day, John told me the story of something that happened in the spring of 2000. It was during a Sunday morning worship service in Columbia, Maryland. John was then 30, and he pastored the Columbia Church of Christ. In his congregation, there was a soft-spoken parishioner named Michael, who was a psychiatrist. Michael was part of the group who had volunteered to be in the rotation to lead worship, and that week it was his turn. But Michael's father, with whom he'd had an incredibly tumultuous and painful relationship, had died recently. His father had been physically abusive with a harsh religious streak. John said he was the kind of Catholic who believed kids needed to be spanked periodically for no good reason, other than it helped beat the original sin out of them and taught them how to suffer like Jesus. Obviously, Michael's not terribly fond of his father. So Michael's father's death was sudden and unexpected, and John could see that Michael was having a very difficult time reconciling his decidedly mixed emotions. More than once, Michael said, "I don't know how people process stuff like this without a church family. I suppose that's what keeps guys like me in business." So that Sunday, John walked into the room where they were gathered for worship when Michael, who was already there, approached him. John saw that he was wearing a sling and walking gingerly. For some reason, John had a bad feeling about it. "John," Michael said, "I've pinched a nerve in my neck. It's made my arm go all pins and needles. It started Friday and was so bad I had to cancel all my patients for the day. I went to my doctor and thought it would be better by now, but it's throbbing. I can't lead worship today. I'm sorry." Michael's eyes were shining, and John could see that it was from tears. He was in real pain, physically, emotionally, spiritually. Obviously, playing guitar and leading worship was out of the question. John's mind began racing immediately. He had a service to lead in a few minutes, but he didn't want to lead the music portion of it and preach too. He thought it would look too much like a one-man show. In mentally scrambling to figure out what best to do, he was probably a bit dismissive with Michael. He told him everything would be fine and said he should get some rest and he hoped he'd feel better soon. After a few quick conversations later, he found someone to fill in for Michael. Then he took a deep breath and the service began. This week, after the first song, as John brightly said good morning to the congregation, he saw Michael sitting off to the side, obviously wincing in pain and discomfort, though he was trying to look pleasant. John realized he couldn't continue. He stopped everything and did something he'd never done before. He now felt something welling up inside of him that he couldn't ignore. So instead of what was scripted, he simply said, "Folks, you know Michael. Your program says he's supposed to lead us in song this morning, but he can't. He's got a pinched nerve in his neck. It's causing him a lot of pain. It actually cost him patience on Friday. You know what? Let's just pray for him right now." John asked Michael to come out of his pew and step forward to where John was standing in front of the congregation. John placed his hand on Michael's good shoulder and then prayed spontaneously. "God, thank you so much for Michael and his servant's heart. You know what a rough year he's had with the death of his father, and you know how much pain he's in right now, inside and out. God, I don't believe this is your best for him. I don't believe you like seeing Michael suffer like this. The pain of grief never goes away in an instant, but the pain in his arm could. You could do that. We'd all love it if you would. But if you don't, continue to make Michael brave and strong and help us to know how to be better friends and neighbors to Michael and others around us. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Michael was visibly moved. John was too. With that, Michael returned to his seat. Then about 10 minutes later, right in the middle of one of the songs, the mild-mannered and soft-spoken Michael literally started jumping up and down. He then came sprinting down to the front, waving his previously bad arm all over the place like a wild man. "He did it, John," Michael said. "He really did it." Michael was never exuberant, but now he actually grabbed a microphone from one of the singers up front and said, "Folks, I don't know how to explain this, but as I was sitting there during worship just now, my arm started feeling really warm, and then it felt like it just kind of breathed a sigh of relief. And now look at this." He waved the arm all over again. The congregation wasn't at all used to this sort of thing happening on Sunday mornings in their church, but neither were they skeptical that something extraordinary had indeed just happened. They knew Michael well enough to understand this was a bona fide miracle, and they all spontaneously began clapping and shouting. After things calmed down and Michael went back to his pew, John proceeded to preach the sermon. But how do you follow something like that? Today, John and Michael lived in different cities, but on those rare occasions where they bump into each other, Michael tells anyone in earshot about the time John healed my arm. And every time he says it, John corrects him, saying that it was the time God healed Michael's arm, and I just happened to be standing there. Allergic to everything. I met my friend Lucy Schaefer in the mid-90s through mutual friends at Redeemer Presbyterian Church on the Upper East Side in Manhattan. Lucy was at the time working long hours as an associate producer for a major news program. Lucy grew up in Manhattan. They, meaning her family, were religiously observant Jews, but culturally assimilated. She said at age 5, she knew she would not only be attending an Ivy League school for college, but that she would go to an Ivy League school for graduate work. As it happened, she did, ending up at Dartmouth as an undergrad, and then at Yale Law School. During her last year of college and into her first year of law school, Lucy started to experience unusual fatigue and would get sick frequently. Then in the summer, after her first year at Yale, she began to experience tremendous allergic reactions. Her allergies to typical things like pollen in dogs and cats had already begun to intensify during college. But suddenly now she became tremendously ill and reacted badly to a host of new things. The smell of perfume and shampoo, the smell of pesticides, and auto exhaust. Her search for help took her to Mass General, where she saw the head of immunology, and then to Yale Medical School and to many other prestigious hospitals in the Northeast. But for all her persistence, she couldn't get a good diagnosis, much less any kind of help. She eventually heard about an immunologist in San Francisco at UCSF who was having some success with a few patients. So she booked a ticket to San Francisco and flew there to see him. Eventually, he had an endocrinologist he was working with. He and an endocrinologist came up with a diagnosis. She had two autoimmune diseases, one that affected her thyroid and the other her ovaries. The doctors were able to control the thyroid disease with extremely high doses of thyroid medication, but there was nothing they could do about the autoimmune disease affecting her ovaries, and the allergies continued to get worse. But as bad as things were, Lucy did not give up hope. She kept searching and trying new things. This led her into all manner of alternative medical cures. Most were very expensive, and none of them helped. So Lucy moved to the desert in Texas, trying to get away from allergies. During this time, Lucy continued to try every doctor possible and every type of treatment. It was during this time in Texas that Lucy met a woman who had something similar and who said she had been completely healed of it by God. And not just God, but Jesus. Lucy realized at that point she had not once in the 4 years she had been dealing with this met a single soul who had been healed of these things, not by a doctor or by any alternative treatments. As it happened, the woman was herself Jewish, and just a few years before had been healed of something very similar to what Lucy had. She explained at that time she could eat only a few foods. In her desperation for a cure, she had visited a tarot card reader. But eventually the fortune teller told her there was nothing she could do for her, and she actually suggested the woman should go to church. So she did. The people at the church prayed over her numerous times, and in the course of about a year, she was completely healed. When Lucy met her, the woman was completely healthy, in graduate school, working full-time, and engaged to be married. Lucy says that despite hearing all of this, she was very hostile to the woman. She absolutely didn't want to hear about Jesus. Lucy's family had been Jewish for many centuries. Her mother's family could trace its roots all the way back to Aaron. Furthermore, the very idea of Christianity repulsed her. The Jimmy Swaggart and Jim and Tammy Faye Baker televangelism scandals were very much in the public eye at that time. The woman realized this and told Lucy that she understood it wasn't something Lucy was interested in, but that if that ever changed, she gave her the phone number of a man who had a degree in Old Testament studies and who she thought would be able to help. Lucy didn't throw away the number, but neither was she expecting to call it. But her encounter with the woman made her willing at least to think more about God. In her desperation, she began reading the Bible. In her own way, she had prayed a number of times over the years for healing and was somewhat angry at God for not doing so. Over the course of the next few years, Lucy met six or seven other people who had said they'd been healed by Jesus of something similar to what she had. She said she got to a point where she couldn't ignore the evidence. Almost no one she had met with this problem had been completely healed by a doctor or an alternative medicine practitioner. But six or seven people claimed to have been healed of it by Jesus. At some point, she called a man whose number she had. The number still reached him. After speaking with him, she'd agreed to study the Bible with him over the phone. Over the course of the next 2 years, she studied the Masoretic text of the Old Testament. She read little of the New Testament, but she surprised herself by eventually coming to believe that it was indeed quite possible, probable, that Jesus was the Messiah to the Jews. But she knew she wasn't going to do anything about it. She was adamantly opposed to accepting him or receiving him or whatever else you say. During those years, Lucy's health continued to deteriorate. She was now living in a foil-lined trailer in the Arizona desert. But after some work on her water supply, when she showered, she wound up getting extremely sick. One day, the effects of the water in the shower caused Lucy to feel so ill that she left the trailer with the shower running. The trailer flooded. She had just recently met a woman who was selling a similar kind of trailer, you know, the tinfoil lining, in which she had herself recovered from a similar illness. So Lucy got in her tinfoil-lined Toyota pickup and drove out to visit her. The woman told her that she had been healed of essentially the same diseases as Lucy. She said Christ had healed her through prayers for healing and deliverance. She then asked Lucy whether Lucy realized that the illness was demonic. Lucy says that she had dealt with so many quack doctors and had considered so many bizarre alternative paths to healing that at this point it didn't sound so strange. It seemed less strange than having the irises of her eyes red to determine which vitamins she needed to take. She was at this point utterly desperate. She was even open to having this woman pray for her. After the day she heard this woman's story, Lucy relented and began to read the New Testament. It was then she said that the Bible became alive for her. It wasn't just a text to be dissected, and she began to believe that God really could heal. Then with some trepidation, she couldn't remember precisely when, Lucy said, "Okay, God, if Jesus is the Messiah to the Jews, then I accept him. If not, please forgive me." The woman and her husband and some others from a local church began to pray for Lucy, and there was over time undoubtedly a positive change, albeit a very slight one. Lucy said it was the first time in 6.5 years that things had improved at all, but that little bit was enough to encourage them, and they continued to meet and pray for the next few months. The woman who had been healed recommended Lucy pray with a woman who is an expert in praying for healing and deliverance. There's a little section about how it was prayed for day after day. Finally, at the end of 5 days of prayer, something happened. It was clear to both of them that something was different. I felt lighter and there was enormous peace, Lucy said. The woman I was praying with confirmed it. She said, "It's over." And I said, "I know." There was no question about it. Lucy was healed. The whole thing was, of course, utterly amazing and dramatic. Lucy's life changed utterly. She found that she could do anything she liked. She could take showers. She could go to any restaurant she liked. She could wear makeup. For years, she had worn only pre-washed cotton clothing and used only kelp-based soap. And now she could go to any store and buy clothing, regular soap, and food. It was a complete turnaround from what she had experienced before. During all of those years, Lucy was on massive amounts of thyroid medicine and other drugs, including transfer factor and intravenous immunoglobulins to try to stimulate her immune system. Now that she was better, she decided she wanted to go off of all those medications. She called one of her doctors in San Francisco who had been prescribing them and explained to him that she had been healed. When he asked how that had happened, she told him flatly that people had prayed for her. "Well, prayer works," he said, as though it were the most normal thing. Lucy was stunned to hear him say that. I'll just pause and ask the question, why hadn't he told her before? Or had she just not been listening? Another of Lucy's doctors explained that going off these medicines, in particular the large dose of hormones that she was taking, would put her body through terrible withdrawals. So if she really was serious about going off them, she would need to exercise. He also cautioned that he thought Lucy would fall ill again without the medication. Lucy decided she would swim while going off the medication. Within 3 months, she was swimming a mile a day. By then, she was completely off the medication and as healthy as she has ever been in her life. And we'll leave that story and go to one entitled Grandfather is Healed. My friends Jeff and Christine live on Long Island, New York, where they run a technology consulting business. Both are Chinese, and Christine came to this country from Taiwan. Christine's first encounter with the miraculous took place when she was 15 years old and living in Taiwan. She had no difficulty believing that God was real, which was to say that he existed, but she didn't know him in any personal ways, although her parents both did. She began to feel that she really ought to try and have a relationship with God in the way that her parents did. So one day she prayed a very simple prayer. "God," she prayed, "I know you are real. Everybody says you are real, but I've never personally experienced you myself. So if you are real, show me that you are real." During this period, Christine's grandfather was living with them. For about 6 months, he had been experiencing some kind of illness, although they knew not what. He was unable to stand up straight or walk at all. That summer, one of Christine's aunts returned to Taiwan from New York. During her time in New York, she had experienced a healing during a church service, which affected her faith dramatically. So at some point, with Christine and her father present, the aunt came into the grandfather's room with great directness asked him, "Do you believe God can heal you?" On hearing these words, the grandfather began to weep. He said, I believe only God can heal me. I've seen doctors, but none of them can help me. I'm just too old." By the way, those are his ellipses. Christine's aunt decided to pray for the grandfather right there. She put her hands on the grandfather's legs and prayed a very powerful prayer that he be healed. A moment after she had finished, the grandfather stood up and immediately started walking. They were all stunned to witness it. Christine said that even now, so many years after it happened, remembering it makes her very emotional. She remembers thinking that she couldn't believe it was possible for a miracle to happen right in front of her eyes. That in just a moment's time, God could wipe away so many months of misery and pain. Christine remembers that moments later, her grandfather decided he must go outside. When the neighbors saw him walking around, they were all stunned. "What happened to you?" they asked. "We haven't seen you in such a long time. How could you be walking?" Her grandfather was beaming with joy and simply continued walking, talking to different neighbors. After that moment, Christine said, "I realized that I would never doubt God again. I suddenly realized just how real he is and how powerful." And the reason this is in yellow is because it's one of the few mistakes that the book made. It didn't close the quotation. A watch stops. It was early Friday morning, May 7, 2004. I was in the sanctuary of St. Paul's Episcopal Church in Darien, Connecticut for a weekly gathering of what we call the New Canaan Society, a group of men that gets together to hear a speaker, to pray, and encourage each other to be better husbands and fathers. The group had grown like a weed, so we had to move out of my friend Jim Lane's house and into this church. This morning, the speaker was our friend Paul Teske. He was then 55 years old and the pastor of a Lutheran church in nearby Westport, also called St. Paul's. So this is one that Eric Metaxas witnessed personally. I introduced Paul and then sat down in the front row to hear his talk. He told us that he had planned on giving a talk titled Christian Ethics and Morality in Business, but at the last minute he had felt led by God to change his direction and instead talked about St. John, the disciple closest to Jesus, who alone among the 12 lived to a ripe old age. He is believed to have been about 90 years old when he wrote what we now know as the Book of Revelation, the last book in the Bible. He was then imprisoned in a Greek penal colony on the Isle of Patmos. What none of us knew as we listened to Paul that morning was that roughly 2 minutes into this 40-minute talk, he found that he suddenly couldn't put any weight on his left leg. He said that when it happened, he was utterly baffled, but instead of stopping, he just clung to the podium, kept his weight on his right leg, and continued talking, as though nothing were the matter. As he was giving his talk, Paul was wondering what in the world was happening. He felt otherwise fine, so he just kept talking and making his points, all the while continuing to puzzle over what had happened to his leg, which just hung there, as he later said, like a sack of potatoes. When Paul was finished with his talk, he calmly said, "Would somebody be able to help me into a chair? I seem to be having a problem with my leg." He was obviously putting all his weight on his right leg while holding onto the podium with both hands. Eric jumped up with a number of other people and tried to grab him, and Paul started to go down, and instead of bringing him to the chair, we found ourselves just easing him onto the carpeted floor of the sanctuary. There was a doctor among us that morning. He came over, knelt down, and began taking Paul's vitals and asking him questions. Paul said he couldn't move his leg or foot at all. Other than that, he felt absolutely fine. Not long after this, an ambulance arrived, and the EMTs took Paul to the hospital. We all stood around wondering what had happened. Paul was told by the doctor in the ER that he didn't seem to be having the symptoms of a stroke. If he'd had a stroke, which is a cerebral hemorrhage, he would likely have had a headache so painful that he would have passed out. I'm not sure that this is exactly straight, but this is what is being reported, what's remembered. Paul confirmed that he hadn't had any pain whatsoever. But after a CAT scan, the doctor said that Paul had indeed had a cerebral hemorrhage, which is to say, a stroke. But he was checked into the CCU for the night. Usually be the ICU, but this what's again being reported. And an MRI was promptly scheduled for the following morning. Once Paul was settled into the CCU, a physician stopped by to let him know that the situation ahead was not at all certain. He said that if Paul's brain began to hemorrhage again, medical intervention was not promising. He even told Paul that it would be best to get his affairs in order just in case. Paul told his wife, Rivers, the news. Then he told her that he had two requests if he were to die. First, that the congregation of his church throw a huge Easter celebration because he would be home in heaven. Paul said, "If there is no resurrection, then I have been in the wrong business." Then he said that he didn't want anyone to wish him back from death. "Who would want to leave heaven for any reason? I will be waiting for the rest of you to finally arrive." They wept and hugged each other, and Rivers went home. The next morning, Paul woke up feeling fine, but he still couldn't move his leg a millimeter. A bit later, he had his MRI. The next day, the doctor came in to say that the MRI hadn't told him much. So they scheduled another test in the hospital's angioplasty unit, but that test also failed to clarify what had happened. This much was clear: a blood vessel had ruptured and then had clotted itself. But no one knew why. The doctor made it clear that he had no real idea whether Paul would be able to walk again. Almost 2 weeks after being in the hospital, Paul had an experience with God. The first thing that happened, he said, was that God impressed a Bible passage on his mind very strongly, so strongly that he knew it was related to his situation. The Bible passage was Hosea 6, 1 through 3, but Paul had no idea what Hosea 6, 1 through 3 said. He just felt that God wanted him to look it up and to know that it was God's promise to him. So he did. Paul read the following. Come, let us return to the Lord. For he has torn, but he will heal us. He has stricken, but he will bind us up. After 2 days, he will revive us. On the third day, he will raise us up, that we may live in his sight. 4 years earlier, Paul had been prayed for by a pastor from Ghana named Kingsley Fletcher. That pastor had prophesied over Paul and said that God was going to do something over a span of 21 days. When that 21-day period was supposed to be, was unclear. But for some reason, when Paul was reading this passage from Hosea, he remembered that prophecy and strongly felt that God was telling him that he would be healed 21 days after he had had his stroke. According to Paul, since he had the stroke on May 7, he reckoned that the day of his healing would be May 28. Paul felt so strongly about this that he wrote about it in his journal and told his wife, Rivers. In fact, he actually told just about anyone who wanted to listen. Paul was supremely convinced that this was what God had told him and that he had no doubt that God would heal him on that date. Paul was released from the hospital on May 20, and the following morning, a Friday, the New Canaan Society would again meet at St. Paul's in Darien. Paul wanted to be there, but of course he couldn't drive. So he asked Rivers to drive him. They would have to leave their house in Westport just after 7 o'clock a.m. Before they left, Paul asked Rivers if she knew where his watch was. She said that it was in his briefcase. It had been locked in there with his cufflinks when they were taken away from him the first day at the hospital. Rivers handed Paul the briefcase as they drove out of the driveway, and there in the passenger seat, he opened it and took out the watch. He immediately saw that the hands weren't moving. Then he noticed that the time on the stopwatch was 7:58, and the date was May 7. The day he had the stroke. The watch had stopped at 7:58 on the morning of the 7th. Of course, he immediately told Rivers as she was driving and they tried to figure out what might have happened. Paul had worn the watch for perhaps an hour after the stroke. The New Canaan Society speakers always ended at around 8:20. The watch hadn't been taken from him until close to 9 o'clock in the morning. And now as they drove towards Darien, he wondered, was the watch broken forever? Paul gave it a little shake, and the hands immediately started working again. Paul's arrival at the New Canaan Society that morning was moving. When asked to say a few words, he hobbled to the podium. We gave him a standing ovation, of course. Paul said that his being there that morning was by God's grace. I'm omitting a few interesting details. If you want them, read the book. Paul felt that he must go to Baltimore to the Benny Hinn Crusade taking place on May 27 and 28. Why, it's not clear. Benny Hinn is the world-famous, if sometimes controversial, preacher with a renowned healing ministry. Paul wanted to be in the audience at Hinn's event on the appointed date. But before he went to Baltimore to claim his own healing, another healing took place. That Tuesday, Paul got a phone call from another Lutheran pastor who was his friend, Pastor Mark Zender, who pastored in Omaha, Nebraska, was calling to say that their mutual friend, Pastor Greg Smith, was ill. Greg had flown in from St. Louis to Connecticut to fill in for Paul when he was in the hospital. But on his return to St. Louis, he experienced tightness in his chest. He immediately saw his own physician, who gave him an EKG and a stress test. They revealed that he had major blockage around his heart and he must come in the following day for an angiogram. If it confirmed what the physicians knew it would, major blockage, Greg would need to have surgery so that a stent could be inserted, or perhaps he would even need bypass surgery. On the phone with Mark, Paul confidently declared that God had Greg's heart in his hand, and Paul said that God was healing his heart, and he even boldly declared that the next day the doctors would be confounded by what they saw. Then Paul and Mark called Greg. Together, Paul and Mark prayed that any damage to Greg's heart would be completely healed and that the doctors, quote, would be confounded, end quote, the next day. That following day, Rivers and Paul left for Baltimore. On the way, Paul left a voicemail message for Greg. Paul felt that what some Christians call an anointing in his prayers and faith for what God was going to do in Greg. In his voicemail, he said that he felt this anointing, or unction as it is sometimes also called. And he said that he saw Greg as the lion-hearted, and he said that Greg would run with the lions. Later that day, Paul got a call from Greg, who was almost speechless as he told Paul about what took place that morning. After the first angiogram test, the physician said he had made a mistake and decided to do another one. After the second angiogram, he said that what the first angiogram showed must be correct. Greg was absolutely fine. There was no blockage whatever, and he could go home. Paul told Greg that God had healed him and informed him that he must tell his congregation about it. Greg was rather less bold than Paul on this score, but he agreed in principle to share this story with his congregation. On Thursday morning, they headed over to the huge arena for the Benny Hinn Crusade. Paul was thrilled to see that they were seated in the fifth row, and then he got moved to the front row to be right down front with something unexpected. I take it back. He was still in the fifth row. Even more unexpected was when Benny Hinn himself came off the stage to pray for a few people. Indeed, as if on cue, he walked over and prayed for Paul and Rivers. It was a gentle prayer. And again, Paul knew his healing was to happen on the 28th, the next day, not the 27th, but Paul and Rivers nonetheless went down under the power of the Holy Spirit. This is a phenomenon in some Christian healing services where the pastor who prays for healing often has the effect of causing the people for whom he is praying to be, quote, slain in the spirit, end quote. For no explainable reason, they wilt and fall down as though the power to stand has gone right out of their bodies. To be sure, some people do this because it seems to be expected of them, but I've spoken to many people who promised me it had nothing at all to do with them and that it was real, and they fell down as soon as they were touched. Still, Paul had not been healed in any discernible way. The next morning, Rivers volunteered to go over to the arena early and save seats for them. Paul followed at 9:30. They were seated in the seventh row when someone approached them. He told them to please follow him to the center section, second row, and then eventually to sit in the front row. The services that morning was wonderful. And at the end, Benny Hinn told all pastors in the audience to please come forward so that he could pray a blessing over them. When it was Paul's turn, he prayed for Paul twice, then a third time. Paul wasn't sure why he was prayed for three times, but he certainly felt blessed, but he had not yet been healed. That Friday evening, Paul again hobbled to the arena with Rivers. Paul said that he could feel the presence of the Holy Spirit as the worship music played and they sang along, worshiping the God Paul felt certain would heal him that very night in that very place. Then it happened. Without any warning, Paul said that he began to involuntarily shake in a way that I cannot duplicate to this day, like a jackhammer that is used to break up concrete. He said that this jerking lasted for about 5 minutes. Around this time, Benny Hinn declared from the stage that there had just been several healings, including someone with a brace. He, that is Paul, knew he had been healed. He shifted his weight onto his left leg, and for the first time in 3 weeks, it could support his weight. Benny Hinn said that everyone who had been healed should come forward. Suddenly, what must have been hundreds of people began walking toward the stage. Then, amid all the clamor and celebration going on in those moments, Benny Hinn suddenly walked straight to the pulpit, looked down directly at Paul and Rivers, and said, "Come up here." This time, Paul walked up the steps normally as though both legs were fine. Paul and Rivers walked towards Pastor Hinn, who had summoned them. "Who are you people?" Hinn asked him. Paul explained that he was a Lutheran pastor from Westport, Connecticut, and mentioned he was friends with Harold Brederson, the famous pastor who Benny Hill knew well. "You are the Lutheran pastor he's always talking about," Hinn said. "Do Lutherans believe in this?" "This one does," Paul said. With that, Benny Hinn touched them both on their hands, as he does, and down they both went. As they were being helped to their feet, someone mentioned to Benny Hinn that Paul had received a miracle that evening. Pastor Hinn told Paul to tell everyone about it, thrusting a microphone toward him. Paul then told the assembled thousands his story. Then Pastor Hinn made it clear that he knew nothing about this healing. He said to the crowd that the reason he had called Paul and Rivers up onto the stage was because God had told him that they were to have a healing ministry. This was certainly a surprise to Paul. And I'm going to drop the rest of the story because it has to do with the healing ministry that Paul had eventually. As I'm looking at this, there's several reactions I have. It's interesting to see that some Protestant ministers have come under fire. I find it interesting that the resurrection is combined with instant access to heaven. I'm not sure exactly how you do that theologically. Now, if one is a skeptic, I think you could say pinched nerves could respond to psychological relief. And it's possible even that the pinched nerve was caused by emotional stress, causing physical tightness and pinched nerves, and then once you can relax, it goes away. But waving the arm around would be kind of inviting a relapse in that situation. Allergies could have some psychological influences affecting them. We know that the immune system is in contact with at least the emotional state. Weakness in both legs, an old Chinese fellow, could be psychologically mediated. Maybe. I'm frankly duly impressed by the apparent instant healing of someone who had an intracerebral hemorrhage. And for that matter, although with less documentation of exactly what's going on, healing of coronary artery disease. Benny Hinn has heretofore not been one of my favorite characters. I am, however, reluctant to blame this healing on the devil. I have to think about the comment of Jesus where he says, "The sheep of I which are not of this fold." It is probably fair to note that conversion does not prove doctrinal orthodoxy, nor for that matter do other miracles, and that includes miracles of healing. The disciples healed when they did not know what the actual job of the Messiah was. Miracles can happen. I think that not all miracles are from God, but I think also even miracles that are from God do not guarantee correct theology. I think miracles do one thing that's really important, and that is they point beyond what many people consider nature. And that's a relatively simple conclusion, doesn't prove very much. But in this age, I think that's a profound conclusion. But that's my opinion. Now it's your turn. We have a comment way in the back.
Maybe I just missed it, but was there a clear MRI of the
The MRI showed that there was something there, but it didn't necessarily tell you what the cause of it was. So he had an intracerebral bleed for no obvious reason. At least that's how I read the story.
Okay, so it was, I was just thinking about the email that you sent out, that it was confirmed to have had it, but not confirmed that was resolved.
No, apparently, there's no recording that anybody did an MRI afterwards. now that he's walking around,
what's the point?
Why would you do one? Yeah. Except for medical curiosity. But again, that's not the usual course for a stroke caused by cerebral hemorrhage. The CT showed it, and that's kind of, for an actual bleed, that's kind of the gold standard. I mean, it was there. The question is, why did it resolve that rapidly? And, as a physician, I have a hard time giving a really good physical excuse for it. That one, in contrast to the other ones, I think, the other ones you can write off on kind of a psychosomatic type of thing. That one, you really can't. And of course, I'm saying you can write it off. I'm saying you can write it off if you want to. It may not be.
Yeah, I guess it makes me think of kind of Revelation 13, where there's certainly a suggestion that there will be these powers that are counterfeits in the end will have power to do spiritual things, to bring down fire from heaven as though they were true spiritual beings with true spiritual power. So I guess those are my questions. One thing I have is there a difference between miracles? Like, let's assume that the devil can do miracles. In some sense, certainly it seems that he tries to make it appear that way. Is there a difference between that we can recognize by what the miracles point to? If miracles are signs and that they point to, say, okay, the character of God, or recognize, for instance, do they encourage us to examine more or to kindly just blindly believe in God? And kind of looking at more how it relates to a character, person, relational analysis, and that's important to analyze. Kind of looking at we live in a relational reality that is where there are multiple relational real beings that have true power, and that the how we ascertain what is going on requires more than just analysis, but requires relational analysis of the characteristics of what is going on.
Well, I'm having a hard time making a relational analysis that shows that the pastor clearly was advocating things that, he doesn't understand the relationship between the resurrection and soul sleep, it sounds like. I'm not sure that's enough for us to be able to say that God wasn't working through him. And if you get into the biblical precedent, there are two precedents. One of them I mentioned already, that was the disciples' healing when they didn't really have a good idea of what the Messiah was doing. And I think everybody pretty much agrees that the healing that they were doing was through the power of God, not the power of the devil. So what that means is there's twofold things. One of them is that because you can heal and God's in it doesn't mean you really understand everything. On the other hand, what it does mean is that God can use people who don't understand everything. In other words, the logical separation cuts both ways.
Is there one more characteristic in that, okay, when Christ talked about the Holy Spirit, he said he will testify of me?
Yes.
Kind of the point that the Holy Spirit in Scripture does not bring glory to himself. He is not like, oh, look at me, look at the miracles, whereas Christ kept saying, do not go broadcast this around. It was
right.
It was much. It was not a bring glory to the miracles, the powers.
And that's that's one of the things that I've always been a little bit uncomfortable with Benny Hinn, is that it sounds too much like Benny Hinn is a great person through whom God works, rather than you can read that in a number of different ways, but. One of them is that all really God's leading if Benny Hinn's abusing it. The other point that I'll make, though, is kind of interesting, and that is that James and John, or the disciples, I think it's James and John, but the disciples definitely, are seeing somebody working miracles in Jesus' name. And they want to tell him to stop. And Jesus says to them, don't stop him, because he who is not against us is for us. So I think we need to be really careful about telling people that, you know, as if they're bringing glory to Jesus' name, but they don't belong to our church family, that we're that somehow we should just write them off as, well, you know, that's the devil. And the miracle that's being related doesn't sound like it's particularly. It sounds like it's more Christ-centered than I'm comfortable saying. Well, this is just, you know, satanic work.
Is there also a principle of the need to focus on truth and relating God's character versus trying to go out and search out, okay, that's the devil, that's the devil, that's the devil. Like, there may or may not be the devil, but just going out and doing that is not going to help anyone. I mean, Ellen White repeatedly warns against that. And that by focusing on God's character, by going to share him, that in any sense, that will be the only thing that in the long term will show anything true or false. That, yeah, in the short term, we may not know and may not be our job.
Yeah. Now, I mean, one of the reasons that I'm bringing this material to your attention is to try to have people think beyond what they usually do, because, you know, we usually are wrapped up in a kind of an Adventist world where we don't even pay attention to what's going on beyond, and if there's anything good happening, why it must, you know. And yet, if Ellen White is any guide, and I think she is, at the end, there will be more, used to be non-Adventists in the church than there will be Adventists. We lose a bunch, we gain a whole bunch more.
And there'll be lots of false things as well.
And it's going to be very interesting as to how Adventists who have always been closed circle are going to react to that reality. What do you do when you don't have control over the votes anymore? Because the newcomers have more. Go ahead.
This morning, I watched a gopher kicking dirt out onto my steps. Along came a cat. I won't call that a miracle, but along came a cat and caught the gopher. And I was cheering and jumping up and down. But the cat played with the gopher a while and then let it go, alive. Scratch the miracle. But what troubles me with the stories you have read this morning is gimmickry. I'll heal you in 21 days. What's that about? What is God doing when he does all of these strange behaviors and conditions and things? I don't think it's God. Ellen White says clearly the devil can make you ill and then take away the cause of the illness and you are healed. And so I'm somewhat skeptical, but I'm certainly turned off by Benny Hinn. You want to see a scandalous afternoon, type in his name and see what you see. It's scary.
It's interesting that Eric Metaxas recognizes that Benny Hinn's, shall we say, controversial.
When you recount the story here about an angiosperm, angiogram. I'm thinking of flowers, angiosperm. Angiogram.
You've been looking at too much pollen lately.
Having clear results. Yeah, that's my training, palynology. It recalls an episode I had at age 49. I'll try and be real brief on that. I was training for the Chicago Marathon. most of you that know me here know that I still run marathons, and I was really in top form. I was going to turn 50 the next year, and I wanted to, with the times I was producing all through my upper 40s, I would be like in the top 2% of age 50 to 59s. And this is in big marathons, but I won't go further into that. So I was really training hard. It was in the fall. I was out camping in central Indiana, and I had a heart attack. And
can we say Giem Fix?
Yeah, Giem Fix is the one that had a heart attack and died, so I'm not Giem Fix, obviously.
Well, yeah, but I mean, he ran all the time.
Yeah, he was in top shape.
Apparently running does not totally prevent heart attacks.
But he had a cholesterol problem, too, that was undetected. So anyway, thanks to some alert friends of mine on this camp out, we got help, and I got to a hospital, and we were able to make contact with my daughter, my doctor back at Andrews University, a graduate, Dr. Hamill, graduate of Loma Linda. So I was kind of under expert watching at that time to see, is it really a heart attack? Warren John shouldn't be having a heart attack if he's running marathons and all this. Well, they diagnosed it as a flu attack more than heart attack. But we sent, by fax, we sent the results to Andrews University to the clinic there. And my doctor looked at it and he said, you better get medical help immediately. The T waves were totally inversed. And all of the signs on the electrocardiogram showed that my heart was very severely in distress, just totally. So trying to make it back to Andrews, I wanted to be local in a hospital there, maybe South Bend, Indiana, where we would have expert help. Made it to Lafayette, Indiana. Ended up in the ICU. They gave me all the treatment for a heart attack. It was diagnosed as heart attack. And they rewired me and checked my EKG, and still very bad. So that was on a Sabbath. The attack came on a Friday night. It also was on October 22. So I thought my day of judgment had come and my end was imminent. It was fearful. It was frightening. I can laugh now. And for years, I didn't even want to talk about it. So I've shared this with students here on this campus and also in small groups. But to make a long story short, there was intense prayer for me at Andrews University. They were having a meeting. They stopped in the middle of the meeting in Pioneer Memorial Church, and the whole church kneeled and prayed for me. And that was great. I didn't know that till afterwards. Well, about 4:30 in the morning, they called a code blue because my blood pressure dropped. The bottom was out of blood pressure. I mean, normally most people would have been dead after that. They gave me Tylenol. They'd given me everything else they could, so I took a glass of water and Tylenol and a couple Tylenols, and it just felt like immediately there was a turning of the oppression. My heart was starting to feel like, hey, I can breathe again. It was affecting my breathing. I felt like circulation is getting through. That was 4:30 a.m., after all it was known, one of my best friends from Andrews, who was at that afternoon service and had been praying for me, she had waken up in the morning. She was a nurse, Wanda, and she intensely prayed for me at 5:30. Now, I thought of the time difference because 5:30 is Eastern time. This is in the summer. Still on summertime, and 4:30 is Indiana time for Northwest Indiana. Mm-hmm. So the very time I was facing the crisis, unbeknownst to me, she was praying. Now, I think that's more than a coincidence. Some of the things we saw on the screen with Benny Hinn, I don't think we can explain it fully, but a lot of it could be coincidence. I think we have to factor that.
And a lot of it could be psychological influences, too.
That we have to factor in the equation. Mm-hmm. Anyway, they did the angiogram afterwards, a day or two afterwards, clear, crystal clear blood vessels. And later it was diagnosed as, say, an attack of virus on my heart. The heart was swollen, very much swollen. The pressure on the coronary arteries was immense. And true, I had a heart attack, but thank the Lord I'm here today.
I try and keep the bar for miracles fairly high.
Yeah, me too.
Because I see things that this could be a coincidence, and my scientific training has engendered some skepticism in my thinking. And there are about 7 or 8 incidents in my life where I think that miracles have happened, and I just thought I'd share one with you. I was asked by the National Oceanic Administration to go to the Bahamas and use their underwater hydro lab. This is an underwater laboratory. I was working on coral. They wanted me to, I turned them down the first time, but they asked me again. Let's go. And so two of my graduate students, one of my graduate, a couple of graduate students and I, three of us would live in this habitat for a week. And these people knew me. I'd been working with them in the Pacific and research, and they knew me. And the second time they called me, I told them, look, the program was you go in on a Tuesday and you go out on a Tuesday. And I told him on Saturday, you know me, and so on. He said, yeah, we know you very well. Saturday, you can just rest in that underwater habitat there and keep your Sabbath. So I went there, had to apply a grant for that, and I applied for the grant 2 days before we flew there. Tells you a little bit about grant applications, but it got in there before.
If they really want you, they can make it work.
Exactly. So here we're there a few days before, and one of the things you have to do is pass a test before they allow you to stay down there. They have to know that you know how to handle yourself underwater, and that you will be competent enough in cases of emergencies and so on. One day, it was the day before the test. I was helping out and carrying some heavy tanks out of a boat, and my back snapped. And tremendous pain in my back. I just couldn't do anything. The next morning, I had to take the test. And I knew there's no way I can take that test with this tremendous pain in my back, and I was in my motel room there, lying down, and I thought, man, I can't even move hardly here. What am I going to do? I have to take this test in the morning, and I prayed to the Lord earnestly. I said, look, I want to be completely submitted to your will, but we're here, we're representing Adventists, we're representing health principles and so on, and And here we can't even do our work. If it's your will, would you please heal me? Instantly, I felt itching in my back. Within 10 seconds, I was healed. I got up and I went to the other front. I told, hey, I'm healed. I have no problem. I can go take the test with you guys. And I took the test and so on. But to me, that I think is more than coincidence. More than coincidence.
Is this man a believer?
What?
Is he a believer, the gentleman who wrote the book?
The person who wrote the book, yeah, definitely he's a believer.
Does he struggle with some of these things that he presents, I wonder?
Yes, one of the things that he has noticed, I mean, he apparently witnessed at least the injury to this, the last story. But he has not had any of the people that he has personally prayed for ever healed, including himself. So, yeah, and it raises the question, why God does this and why he doesn't do that, and, you know, is God capricious, all those kinds of things. And I don't know that he has a really good answer for that. At least he hasn't put one into the book. So I think we have... Well, I can say this much. We are not dealing with somebody who has all the answers. And we're dealing with somebody who knows he doesn't have all the answers.
And the Lord says, if it were possible, even the very elect would be deceived.
Mm-hmm.
We have to be so careful. We have to be so very careful. The Lord told Satan, you can do anything you want to Job. I have full confidence in him, but do not take his life. Satan can easily cause us trouble. And the Lord, in his goodness, to glorify his name, relieves us of that. Think of as Grinkov. What's his first name? 2 times world champion ice skater. Died in New York with his wife over his head. Sergei Grinkov, 28 years old, dying of a heart attack. Perfect health.
Well, obviously not, but
apparently perfect health. That's the word I missed out. Yeah, so we as believers, we have to be so very careful as we live our lives and as we trust in his holy name. We see, are we there to question every miracle? Absolutely not. But I think we all need to be convinced in our own ways. And trust in his dealings and leading in our lives.
Well, one of the questions that I will raise just for thinking about it is, How much do you have to know before God will give you a miracle?
My grace is sufficient for you.
Okay, comment here and then in the back.
I haven't really shared my philosophy on healing and miracles, and I hesitate to do so with so many experienced medical personnel right in this room as well as on this campus. But... just based on my own experience and my studies of the Bible, healing is often a divine-human cooperation. Even in the scripture, we have evidence. Hezekiah was sick unto death. Now, we have no diagnosis of what that sickness was, but he took figs, was it? According to the Bible, he took figs. So there may have been a poultice. There may have been some healing power there to counteract the poisons. And I was a pastor once. I had a church member tell me about terrible boils that he had on the back, upper back. And he found someone that applied a poultice of raisins, grind up and put the raisins on. I don't know if that worked, if that was what it was, but the boils were better. So we could probably come up with maybe a rationale that is supported by medical science. Mm-hmm. And so God works through human means as well as what we would call a miracle without human cooperation.
That's true. One thing I'll point out, and that is that, although, as I say, some of these things you can argue that some of it's psychosomatic.
True.
The CT with bleeding, to make that go away, that's pretty impressive. But the other thing that I think is important is that whether you attribute this to God and say that God works through Benny Hinn all the time, or whether you attribute it to God and say God worked through Benny Hinn this time because he had an agenda for somebody else, or whether you want to say that this is, you know, some kind of counterfeit healing that God really didn't have anything to do with, in any one of those three cases, you are not dealing with nature all by itself. And I think that, you know, this is really one of the important things to take from this, is that while there are lots of answers that you can give and we can argue about which one of them is most likely, the one answer you can't give is that, well, you know, things happen and this is all part of the laws of nature. Because it isn't. We have a comment back there.
I think as we near the end of time, we're going to see increasing numbers of things that we can't explain. But Ellen White says, only those who by diligent study of the scriptures have fortified the mind with the truths of the Bible will be able to stand. And I think that's going to be our only way to stand. We can't answer every question about healing or non-healing or this miracle or that miracle, but we can fill our minds with the truths of the Bible.
And that will work regardless of which hypothesis is correct. Yes.
And I think one of the most pertinent things about these things happening at the end of time is that the devil will use these in connection with preaching that you know, certain things from the Bible are not right. And so that's probably the biggest important thing to watch for.
Yeah, and like I say, other than this guy's misunderstanding about the resurrection, I really can't point to a specific theological thing that I'm going to argue about in at least what's presented in the book. Anyway, next week we will finish, and then we'll get back to our usual dull stuff.
Pessimist is better information.